Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 6. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commanded for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith Enoch was taken from this life, so that he did not experience death. He could not be found, because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God, and without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him.
You've probably made a statement to others around you before that goes something like, give me something to go by. Just show me how to do that. And then once they've shown you how to do that, you say, okay, show me that again. I didn't quite get it the first time. I'd really like an example. Could you please take the time and just show me? So much of what we learn in life is learned just that way, by imitation and by observation, by someone else demonstrating for us how it's done. Especially in the early years with Coleman, and even in more recent years as he closes in on his 24th birthday next Sunday, a lot of that teaching has been done hand over hand, which is just exactly what it sounds like. You place your hand on his, guide him through the process until, through extensive repetition, muscle memory takes over and he just starts doing it by himself. A lot of you are do-it-yourselfers, and the do-it-yourself universe just keeps on expanding. You've got your own network, the DIY network, which was rolled out by Scripps Networks Interactive as a follow-up to their wildly successful HGTV. There was so much that was so popular there, they just spun off an entire do-it-yourself network. If you need to figure out how to do something, you just type it into the search bar on YouTube and someone will show you exactly how to do what you're wanting to do. Embarrassingly, about 3 years ago, I had to Google, where's the battery in a GMC Acadia? Wouldn't start one Saturday morning. We had had it long enough. I knew we'd never replace the battery. Wasn't even thinking about trying to jump it off. I just thought, Saturday I'll go to Walmart and get a new battery. So I popped the hood to take out the old battery, and there was no battery. And I found a positive post and a negative post that could be used in jumping it off. And I don't claim to be a mechanic by any stretch of the imagination, but up until that point I'd always been able to find a battery within a car. And from the posts, there were cables leading back to the back of the engine compartment, back to the buried treasure of a battery somewhere. And so I looked underneath the glove box if there was a secret compartment there. I thought maybe they lead all the way back to the cargo area, took up the carpet, lifted out the little plastic piece where you get down to the spare, thinking maybe the battery is there. There is no battery in this GMC Acadia, but there had to be. I was completely stymied, so I had to go online. As a very humble Tigger, I had to go to the computer and type in, where is the battery on a GMC Acadia? And thankfully, there was a diagram that showed me where. I couldn't find it in the owner's manual at all as to where it was. It was between the passenger seat and the second row seat, underneath the carpet, under a compartment, you know, that had to be taken off. Even the tracking device on the second row seat had to be removed in order to get that piece off to get the battery out. And I would have loved to have seen the notes and the minutes from that meeting in the engineering department at GM as to who came up with that. Who was sick that day and didn't run that back through the process to see if there was anywhere else that battery could be put. Thankfully, there were resources available that showed me where the battery was. Over the last 14 months or so, as we've looked at various aspects of our vision and our purpose and our mission, we've looked at that kind of do it like this imitation from God. Those quarterly themes that we had last year, be holy as I am holy. Love as I have loved you. Forgive as I have forgiven you. Be one as I am one. Look to me. Look at me. Do as I do. Be as I am. God is not one of these do as I say and not as I do kind of gods. And that sort of mentality never flies very far with him, if at all. Jesus rebuked the Pharisees and the teachers of the law in Matthew 23, 1 through 4, when he says that the teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. So you must be careful to do everything that they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy, cumbersome burdens and put them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Jesus says, you can listen to their teaching. Some of that is really, really good. But if you want to figure out how to do this, don't look at them. Because they don't know how to do it. They don't practice it. They won't show you how. They won't demonstrate what God means. One of the incredible blessings and accomplishments of the incarnation was not just so that as a spotless and blemishless lamb, Jesus could lay down his life for ours as a once-for-all sacrifice, perfect sacrifice for our sins, but also so that God could say, now the Word having become flesh, here let me show you how I want you to live. Meet my Son that I love, my Son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to Him and live like Him. He will show you how. And that's why we focused so much on Matthew 10, 25. It's enough for the disciple that he be like his teacher. 1 Peter 2:21, Jesus left us an example to follow in his steps. And that's all well, fine, and good, but I understand if that seems a little lofty to you, to just be like God is, to just act like Jesus, think like Jesus, treat people like Jesus. It may be too much of a stretch. It may seem a little out of reach, even though he was fully human. Even though he was tempted in every way like we are, can I really be like him? Can I truly reflect the nature of God in whose image I was created? But it takes on a greater feel of attainability when we're urged to follow the example of other people like ourselves. So it's heartening to read in 1 Corinthians 11:1, where Paul writes, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." That sounds a little more attainable. That sounds a little more reachable because Paul seems to be a lot more like me. That brings it a little closer to home, sounds a little more in line with my skill set. Even before the text that Nathan read for us from Hebrews 11, back in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12, the writer says, "Imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised." Imitate people of patience. That's good. Imitate people of faith. Okay, people like who? And the writer, speaker, preacher of Hebrews says, "I'm so very glad you asked. Let me tell you about some of those people that you should imitate in regard to their faith, in regard to their patience." And that's our Hebrews chapter 11. He says, "Be like some of those ancients, some of the people from generations and ages and millennia gone by, people that have long since been dead and buried. They lived by faith. They were commended by God for their faith. And these were people like Abel." Verse 4 that Nathan read for us, "By faith, Abel brought God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings." Better sacrifice, not a perfect sacrifice. There's only been one perfect sacrifice, and that was offered by the second Adam, Jesus Christ, not the second son of the first Adam. But it was a better sacrifice because, unlike Cain's, Abel's offering was motivated by trust in God. It was motivated by love of God and submission to Him. It was offered to God in thankfulness in order to honor Him and to please Him and to praise Him. And so He offered the best of what he had. The text tells us that he was a keeper of flocks, so you would expect him to bring an animal sacrifice, but it wasn't just an animal sacrifice. The text says that he offered fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. He offered the best of the best. He offered the cream of the crop. He offered the top of the heap and the top 10%. And in contrast to that, Cain's offering wasn't motivated by faith and trust and love of God at all. Was it just ritual for him? Was it just routine? Was it mere requirement? I don't know. I just know it wasn't motivated by faith. He brought what you would expect him to bring. He's a worker of the soil, and so he brings the fruit of the ground, as you might expect, but there are no comparative or superlative modifiers connected with his offering. No descriptors, no adjectives. Seems like he felt he did just what he felt like he had to do. You need a sacrifice? Okay, here's a sacrifice. Maybe surplus produce or bruised or damaged or rotting fruit and vegetables, things that he would never miss, which answers that question, when is a sacrifice not a sacrifice? When it doesn't cost you anything. When it's not a sacrifice. When nothing will be missed. And apparently Cain offers nothing that he would miss. Understand as well from both this lesson that's drawn from Hebrews 4 in the text that's in Genesis 4, we're not reading about worship wars here. Worship is not a competitive sport. This wasn't a single elimination worship tournament in which Cain was just one and done. You got one shot at this and everything rode on that one offering. He wasn't evaluating their sacrifices like a judge at the state fair. It went deeper than that. It went to their heart. Their offerings were expressions of their hearts. One had a heart of faith, the other didn't. That's why the text in Genesis 4 says that God looked with favor upon Abel and upon his offering. And he didn't look with favor upon Cain and upon his offering. The great thing about Abel was Abel and his heart and his faith. The bad thing about Cain was Cain and his heart. His offering was just an expression of that. That's why Jesus will refer in Matthew 23:35 to righteous Abel, and why John in his first epistle, chapter 3, verse 12, will say, don't be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brothers were righteous. That's where this whole acceptability and unacceptability came from. He murdered his brother because he hated him, and he hated him because jealousy dwelled where love should have abided. Selfishness lived where faith should have resided. And so he says, this is the kind of faith I'm talking about, a faith that wants to honor God, please God, praise God with the things that we offer him. And so the writer in verse 4 in Hebrews 11 says, by faith Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. He is a dead man talking. He is among the talking dead that I'm talking about. These people who have long since been gone, their faith still speaks. Abel's been dead longer than anybody else has ever been dead upon the face of the earth. And yet he still speaks because only his body died. Abel never died. His body died. Abel's never stopped living. And so his faith continues to speak. By faith, he speaks just like his blood cried out from the ground to the ears of the Lord. A faith like Abel's, a faith like Enoch's. Verse 5, by faith Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God took him away. If you go back to Genesis 5, verse 23, it says Enoch walked faithfully with God. Then he was no more because God took him away. If there are no gaps in the genealogy there in Genesis 5, which I don't assume there to be, it doesn't seem like it's written that way, then we're just seven generations into the human race. And this man, Enoch, Methuselah's father. Although people had begun to call on the name of the Lord in the days of Enosh, who was the son of Seth, we're still just three generations away from Noah, and we know what the world's like in those days. So I'm assuming that wickedness and violence were greatly increasing, even in Enoch's day, upon the earth. And yet he stayed focused on the things of God. He was confident in what he hoped for. He was assured about what he could not see. So much so that God said, just seven generations into the human race, I'm going to spare you from death. And he just took him right up into his presence. The verse here in Hebrews 11, I'd never really thought about it this way before until this past week, but it says that he could not be found, which seems to indicate people were looking for him. They didn't know where he went. He had his own personal rapture and apparently didn't leave a note behind as to where he's gone. Where is Enoch? And he was taken so young. He was 365 years old. You go back and read the text. He was just 365. Remember the context there. And my math could be wrong. I'm not a mechanic. I'm not a mathematician. You can check my math later. Not now, please. But it seems from the text, I went back and added up the years, Adam's only been dead 57 years. When Enoch is taken, Seth is still alive. And all the generations afterwards, not a lot of people are dying. Not a lot of people are disappearing. And Enoch's just gone. He's on the missing persons list, I guess, all the way till the flood. They're looking for him. Where is he? This wasn't just a fact for Bible trivia. Elijah's the only one that's going to be able to go into the presence of the Lord, bypassing death. But this is unprecedented. This is a phenomenon. This has people talking. A man of such great faith that God just takes him. And then three generations later, Noah. By faith, Noah was warned about things not yet seen. In holy fear, he built an ark to save his family. There was a time, Genesis 2:6 says, that it hadn't rained on the earth. Things were watered by streams from the ground or a mist from the ground. And whether that's still the case in Noah's day, there's really no way to know whether it had rained or not, but it had never rained like God said it was going to rain. Nothing had ever happened like that. There's no way that Noah could have envisioned the springs of the great deep bursting forth and the floodgates of the heavens being opened for 40 days relentlessly until everything on the earth is covered. But against all previous evidence and all history and all personal experience and all odds, Noah still believed because he trusted, and that's what faith is. I trust God. God says it's going to happen. I guess I'd better get ready. And so he submitted and he obeyed and he worked and he built. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go to a place he would receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he didn't know where he was going. Go to a land that I will show you. Abraham is told. Place he had never been. Can't just go to Google Maps and find out primary routes and alternative routes to this place. No Google Earth to get satellite images of this place you're supposed to go. No estimated time of arrival, but he goes. By faith, Sarah, verse 11 says, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. Genesis 11:30 says that the fertility issues didn't lie with Abraham all those years. Genesis 11:30 says that Sarah was childless because she was unable to conceive. And the only way she was able to conceive was through faith. Faith in God, trust in his promise. And God said, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make you the mother of nations. I'm going to make you the mother of peoples. I'm going to make you the mother of kings. And she believed that. A bit later in the text, by faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead. He had never seen that happen, but he deduced that it must be possible. And so, in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from the dead. If you'll look with me at verses 13 through 16 of Hebrews 11, all these people were still living by faith when they died. Enoch being the exception, he was living by faith when he was taken. They didn't receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had an opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Them being people like the ones we have already discussed and the ones that follow. Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and Moses and Rahab and the rest. And of this entire cloud of witnesses, if you'll skip down to verse 32, it says, "And what more shall I say? I don't have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, and David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, gained what was promised, shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground." And again, that not being the context in which we have been blessed enough to have been spared an existence of having to live in places like that, it may seem a stretch to us that we can live like they lived. Yeah, Tim, you know, you don't understand. I'm not sure I can imitate people like that. I can't be like them because I have struggles and I have issues and I stumble and I fall and I doubt and I fear and I question. And the good news is, all those people would feel right at home with you because they did too. I don't know what Abel and Enoch's faults and sins were, but I know they had them. I know that Noah got drunk and passed out naked in his tent, and this was after spending over a year on the cruise ship of righteousness, after he had been among the eight that weren't wicked like everybody else was. This was after that. I know that Abraham lied to two kings about Sarah's identity, not to protect her, to protect himself out of fear. I know that he fell on his face and laughed when God told him that he and Sarah would have a son in their old age, and that Sarah, while she's given this promise, you're going to be the mother of nations, the mother of people, the mother of kings, she laughs too, and then when God calls her on it, she lies to him about it. Never a good idea. When God calls you on something, just admit it. Just tell him, yeah, I'm sorry, and tell him why you did it. Don't make excuses. Don't lie. She does both. God blesses her anyway. And she is hailed as a person of faith. Isaac lied about his wife, Rebekah, and then along with Rebekah, foolishly showed favoritism among their two sons. Jacob, one of those sons, follows a pattern of manipulation and deceit in his life, and then exhibits the same favoritism among his sons that had led to a nearly lifelong rift with his brother Esau, and it turns out just as poorly among his sons as it had among between himself and his brother. Moses leads the people for 40 years in the wilderness, but personally can't close the deal and lead the people into the land of Canaan because he chose not to treat God as holy, took honor for himself at a very, very critical moment. Rahab sold her body as a profession and as a way of life. Gideon made all kinds of excuses before the Lord, and then after this great deliverance leads the people into idolatry after this incredible victory. And Barak, we wonder why Barak's name is even there and why Deborah isn't mentioned, because if it weren't for her, he would have never gone into battle in the first place. Let's not even get started on Samson this morning. went back and read that entire narrative this past week. Yeah, he's here too. Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, and Samuel and the prophets. Jephthah with his foolish vow, David with his adultery and his murder. Like us, these people were far, far from flawless, but they were faithful. They doubted, they feared, they questioned, they laughed, and they clung to their faith, and they persevered anyway. They believed in and kept serving God in spite of their weaknesses and were forgiven because of their faith. And through them, we're encouraged and we learn that God is big enough for our doubts and our skepticism and our confusion and our frustration and our anger and our intemperate outburst and our boneheaded mistakes that we just seem to keep making in our lives. The cross of Jesus is large enough to carry all of our sins. The blood of Jesus is powerful enough to wash them all the way. What characterizes these people in Hebrews 11 from the people that aren't there is that they trusted, they believed, they had faith. Do I believe? Do you believe? Do you trust? Do I trust? Enough to obey Him, enough to submit. It is sweet to trust in Him, because when we trust in Him, He fulfills His promises for us. Promises of forgiveness and grace, promises of mercy and restoration and redemption. If that's an offer you need to claim this morning through professing your faith in Jesus Christ and being united with Him in baptism for the forgiveness of your sins, we would love to assist you with that acceptance of salvation this morning. If you need prayers, if you need support, if you just need to be surrounded by people who love you, please come and make those needs known to our shepherds as we stand and sing this song together.